Some people have argued ADHD is merely a social construct, with the division between normal and abnormal completely arbitrary. By using real-life impairment resulting from the symptoms, the diagnosis can be made less subjective and arbitrary. ADHD is identified and diagnosed by its symptoms. It is generally agreed that these symptoms result from one or more neurological deficiencies, but the specific deficiencies and the best way to treat them are areas of hot debate and active research. The primary theories are dopamine deficiencies, low arousal to external stimuli, and working memory deficits. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter that controls the flow of information coming from other parts of the brain. By emphasizing important stimuli and suppressing others, it functions like a traffic light for incoming information. Hypodopaminergia has also been implicated as a possible cause for deficits in executive functioning, which is responsible for planning, initiating and inhibiting actions, and selecting relevant sensory data. The high effectiveness of stimulants with dopaminergic effects as treatment for ADHD in double-blind controlled trials has supported this theory for over 30 years. According to the low arousal theory, people with ADHD react less to external stimuli than people without the disorder. In order to maintain the level of mental arousal necessary to be focused and attentive, a person with ADHD will try to generate additional stimulation by walking around, fidgeting, talking, or bouncing in their chair. This theory has been supported twofold. First, by the effectiveness of stimulants independent of dopaminergic effects. Both methylphenidate and caffeine have proven effective in low doses at increasing mental arousal and decreasing hyperactive and inattentive behavior. Additionally, the use of bright colors to emphasize tasks has been shown to be highly effective at drawing and maintaining attention towards the current task and increasing overall performance, even when the added color had no relation to the specific task. Recent studies have shown statistically significant correlation between demands on working memory and hyperactive behavior. An extension of the low arousal theory, the working memory model suggests that hyperactive behavior is a direct result of increased demands on working memory, and that the hyperactive behavior consistently ceases immediately following a decrease in working memory demand. In addition to the uncertainty about which deficits cause ADHD, the causes for the proposed deficits are unknown and also under active research. Current theories can be separated into two basic categories, environmental and genetic. Research studies have shown that ADHD may be caused by toxins introduced during pregnancy and early development, such as alcohol, tobacco, lead, and certain insecticides. Premature birth and certain artificial food colorings have also been correlated with ADHD. In the genetic category, multiple twin studies have indicated that the disease is highly heritable and that genetics are a factor in 75% of all cases. In a recent study of over 30,000 patients, subjects with ADHD were significantly more likely than controls to have large, rare, chromosomal structure abnormalities that have previously been associated with other neurodevelopmental disorders, including intellectual disability, schizophrenia, and autism. Although it is safe to assume that genes play a role in ADHD and its heritability, ADHD is best understood as the result of a complex interaction of genetic and environmental factors that are not yet clearly understood. Although some DSM-IV recognized disorders can be maintained through external influences or behavioral patterns, given that symptoms of ADHD are caused by neurological differences, ADHD is considered to be an incurable but manageable disorder. As a result of the wide variety of possible deficiencies and resulting symptoms, treatment for ADHD is usually planned on a very individualized basis to address the patient's specific symptoms and deficiencies. The most effective and most commonly used treatment plan is a combination of medication and behavioral therapy. The most commonly used medications for treatment of ADHD are stimulants with dopaminergic effects, such as methylphenidate and dextroamphetamine, commonly known as Ritalin and Adderall, respectively. These drugs are believed to reduce ADHD symptoms by increasing dopamine, thereby allowing the brain to self-regulate incoming stimuli. Another recently released medication is atomoxetine, marketed as Strattera, which is a selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. Originally intended as an antidepressant, atomoxetine has been highly effective at treating ADHD without the withdrawal and abuse risks associated with stimulants. In addition to medication, most psychologists recommend behavioral therapy to provide special attention to areas where people with ADHD generally struggle. These include organization and management of time, tasks, and distractions. The most commonly taught skills are using a calendar and a task list, breaking down overwhelming tasks into smaller steps, and writing down distractions for later instead of acting on them right away. In addition to therapy for the patient, education is generally recommended for parents and teachers who will be working with the patient. This generally involves instruction about ADHD and suggests certain techniques like highlighting that have proven to be very effective when teaching people with ADHD. In addition to these basic skills, therapy sessions are usually specifically tailored to the patient's needs. Due to the high incidence rate of ADHD and enhanced creativity, some have chosen to regard ADHD as a difference rather than a disorder. They argue that perceived impairment is due to the strict academic mold posed in the modern education system. Students with ADHD think and learn differently from the way they are taught and tested, resulting in significant academic difficulties. This also explains the perception that children grow out of their ADHD, or it just goes away when they complete their formal education. Instead of ADHD going away, the release from a specific learning and knowledge application process allows the child to learn and work in a way that their ADHD symptoms do not cause impairment. Some have even extended this farther out to claim that ADHD is a gift, because an inability to focus solely on a single idea can enable thinking outside the box and result in new and unique solutions to a problem. While it is difficult to say anything definitive about ADHD due to the many uncertainties about the neurological and underlying causes, research and debate over ADHD will likely continue for many years as scientists continue to learn more about the true final frontier, the human brain.